Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Roman Empire, A Very Short Introduction by Christopher Kelly. Narrated by Richard Davidson.
Introduction. The Roman Empire was a remarkable achievement. At its height, in the 2nd century AD, it had a population of around 60 million people, spread across 5 million square kilometers, roughly 20 times the area of the United Kingdom. Then the empire stretched from Hadrian's Wall, in drizzle-soaked northern England, to the sun-baked banks of the Euphrates in Syria. From the great Rhine-Danube river system, which snaked across the fertile flatlands of Europe, from the Low Countries to the Black Sea, to the rich plains of the North African coast, and the luxuriant gash of the Nile Valley in Egypt. The empire completely encircled the Mediterranean. This was the Romans' internal lake, complacently referred to by its conquerors as Mare Nostrum, our sea. This book aims, briefly, to explore some significant aspects of this imperial superstate. Its approach is resolutely thematic, not through any dislike of chronology, but because there are already a good number of useful accounts both of the narrative history of the Roman Empire and of the reigns of individual emperors. This book takes a different path across the same territory. Chapter 1 looks at the brutal process of conquest, at the establishment of empire, and at the Roman sense of their own imperial mission. Chapter 2 considers the presentation of imperial power. It looks at emperors both as gods, in the promotion of the imperial cult, and as men, in the often unflattering histories of Suetonius and Tacitus. Chapter 3 shifts perspective in order to understand the workings of empire from the point of view of the privileged elites in the cities of the Mediterranean. It was these wealthy men, rather than some vast imperial administration, who were principally responsible for the orderly government of the provinces. Chapter 4 exploits some of the less well-known literature of the 2nd century AD, written by Greeks under Roman rule. These are precious texts. They offer a sense, rarely recoverable for pre-modern empires, of how those who were conquered sought to establish an identity in a new imperial world. In the Roman Empire, disputes about the present were often conducted through debates about the past. History writing was not an isolated academic exercise. Rather, it directly engaged with the language of politics and power. The present may have been resolutely Roman, but the past was still to be fought over. Chapter 5 turns to consider the growth of the most important group of outsiders in the Roman Empire. Christians and their faith were fundamentally shaped by their experiences on the margins of society. By contrast, Chapter 6 offers an insider view, seeking to establish some sense of what it might have been like to live and die in the towns and fields of this huge pre-industrial empire. Chapter 7, the final chapter, looks back at Rome from three modern perspectives: from the British Empire in the decade before the First World War, from the fascist Italy of Mussolini, and from Hollywood. These views are important in a number of significant and sometimes surprising ways. They still determine how, at the beginning of the 21st century, the Roman Empire is both imagined and judged. Certainly, it is one of the privileges of the present to be able to look back selectively at the past. But equally, as with this very short introduction, it is always important to be aware of that selectivity. This book concentrates on the Roman Empire at the peak of its prosperity. For the most part, it focuses on two centuries, roughly 31 BC to AD 192. From the victory of the future Emperor Augustus over Antony and Cleopatra at the Battle of Actium, to the assassination of the Emperor Commodus. Although Chapter 1 looks back to the Punic Wars, and Chapter 5 briefly looks forward to the beginning of the 4th century AD, in order to conclude with the conversion of Constantine, the first Roman emperor publicly to support Christianity. The principal concern of the following chapters is to understand Rome's achievement in establishing and maintaining one of the largest world empires, and the only one to have embraced Northern Europe, the Middle East, and North Africa. That success in itself demands a rich and complex explanation. Only then is it possible to begin to understand the reasons for the subsequent weakening of Roman power, the eventual breakup of the empire in the West into barbarian kingdoms, and the gradual emergence of Byzantium in the East. These themes run far beyond the compass of this book. The best account of that awful revolution remains the magisterial treatment of Edward Gibbon, The History of the Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, London, 1776 through 1788. But the unwary enthusiast should take note. At 6 substantial volumes, it was never Gibbon's intention to offer anything approaching a very short introduction. Chapter 1. Conquest. Expansion and survival. Rome was a warrior state. Its vast empire had been hard won in a series of fiercely fought campaigns. In the 4th century BC, Rome, then an unremarkable city, secured its survival through a complex network of alliances with surrounding peoples. A series of victories allowed the Romans to establish their own territory along the Tiber Valley and to expand their sphere of influence southwards into Campania around the Bay of Naples. This was a slow process of gradual advance and steady consolidation. Notable breakthroughs came with the defeat of the Samnites in 295 BC, leading to the extension of Roman control into central Italy, and the thwarted invasion of Pyrrhus, the ruler of Epirus, a kingdom on the Adriatic coast of Greece. In 280 BC, Pyrrhus landed his army at Tarentum, modern Taranto, on the heel of Italy. Despite initial success, he was unable to force a Roman surrender. After 5 years campaigning in Sicily and southern Italy, rather than stretch his limited resources and risk defeat, Pyrrhus withdrew. By the middle of the 3rd century BC, most of the Italian peninsula was under Roman control. In the next 100 years, the Romans and their allies challenged the North African city of Carthage, the dominant power in the western Mediterranean. A fleet of merchant ships guaranteed Carthage's continued prosperity and international influence. Sailing east to Egypt and Lebanon to trade in luxury goods, north, perhaps as far as Britain, to purchase tin, and south along the African coast to bring back ivory and gold. Against this threatening rival, 3 long conflicts, known as the Punic Wars, stretched the Romans to their limits. The immediate cause of the First Punic War, 264 through 241 BC, was a dispute over Sicily. The Romans regarded the escalating Carthaginian military presence on the island as a direct threat to their own security. Yet no serious opposition could be offered without an effective means to counter Carthage's command of the seas. The Romans, whose victories in Italy had been based on the superiority of their army, were forced to build a permanent navy. Soldiers were hurriedly retrained as sailors. Later tradition would claim that skilled carpenters had copied the construction of an enemy vessel which had run aground, building 100 ships in 60 days. In the end, this risky strategy paid off. In 241 BC, after 23 years of bitter warfare, the Romans were finally able to enforce a complete Carthaginian withdrawal. An uneasy peace lasted little more than 20 years. In the Second Punic War, 218 through 201 BC, the great Carthaginian general Hannibal, in one of the most daring and imaginative military campaigns in the ancient world, marched his army of 50,000 men, 9,000 cavalry, and 37 elephants from Spain, across southern France, and over the Alps into Italy. Fewer than half the men survived the journey. 7 months later, in May 217, in the early morning mist, Hannibal trapped the Roman general Flaminius and his troops at Lake Trasimene in Umbria, killing 15,000 men. The following year, he nearly wiped out the Roman army at Cannae in Apulia. This was the severest defeat ever inflicted on the Romans. In one battle, they lost 50,000 men, the highest death toll for an army in a single day's fighting in the history of European warfare. And unlike the casualties at the Somme, the Roman soldiers at Cannae fell in hand-to-hand combat, their corpses piled high across a bloody plain. Hannibal occupied Italy for 15 years. Under the command of Fabius Maximus, admiringly nicknamed Cunctator, the Delayer, the Romans and their allies deliberately avoided pitched battles. Instead, they burned their own crops and retreated to fortified towns. Slowly starved by this scorched earth policy and harried by Roman raiding parties, Hannibal's army was forced to abandon the campaign. The Romans were victorious, but not for a long decade after Cannae. It was not until 202 that Hannibal, recalled to defend Carthage, was defeated at the Battle of Zama in modern Tunisia by Scipio Africanus. 60 years later, a revived Rome returned to eliminate a much weakened and demoralized Carthage. The Third Punic War, 149 through 146 BC, ended with the complete destruction of the city. Its buildings were systematically leveled and most of its 50,000 surviving inhabitants enslaved. Expansion westward into Spain and North Africa was matched by war in the east. By 146 BC, the year in which both Carthage and Corinth were sacked, all the major cities in the Balkan Peninsula were subject to Rome. In the following century, after a series of difficult campaigns, Asia Minor was finally secured. In the 60s, the successful general Pompey the Great annexed Syria. In the 50s, Julius Caesar conquered Gaul, from the Pyrenees in southern France to the Rhine. In 31 BC, his adopted son Octavian defeated Cleopatra VII, the last independent ruler of Egypt. That victory in a naval battle off Actium in northwestern Greece brought the greatest prize. Egypt, the oldest and wealthiest kingdom in the Mediterranean, was now fully part of the Roman Empire. In the wars against Carthage and in the East, Rome's traditional republican system of government had worked tolerably well. Indeed, the 2nd century BC, with its string of military conquests, is conventionally regarded as the apogee of the Roman Republic. Yet in some ways, republic is a misleading term. It risks implying, at least for modern readers, too great a degree of popular participation in politics. This is not an ancient difficulty. The Latin res publica is best translated simply as affairs of state. The Roman Republic was an unabashed plutocracy. The citizen body was carefully graded according to stringent property qualifications. In turn, This classification regulated voting rights. All adult male citizens were enfranchised. But a system of electoral colleges guaranteed that the rich, if united, would always be able to outvote the poor. In addition, the heavy costs of electioneering and office holding ensured that all who were most prominent in government were themselves personally wealthy. Under this tightly oligarchic constitution, two consuls, the most powerful officials in the state, were elected each year. Only those who had held the praetorship, the next most senior magistracy, and were at least 42 years old, were permitted to stand. During his term in office, a consul might expect an important military command, which could then be extended for further annual terms. At the expiry of his stint in the field, an ex-consul relinquished his commission and returned to the Senate. Not a directly elected body, but rather an advisory council made up of all those who had held senior magistracies. This pattern of annual office holding, age-restricted eligibility, and time-limited military commands enforced some degree of collective power-sharing amongst the Roman ruling elite. In the late 3rd and 2nd centuries BC, about half the consuls came from 10 extended families, an indication not only of the stable dominance of a small hereditary group, but also of a considerable degree of fluidity outside this core. Men without recent senatorial ancestry, or none at all, regularly reached the Senate in large numbers. The Republican Constitution also imposed a deliberate restraint on any ambitious individual. Above all, it prevented the long-term concentration of political or military authority in the hands of victorious generals. The true test of a great man, at least for Roman moralists, was not his ability to achieve high office, but his open-handed willingness to relinquish it. When Rome was first struggling to establish itself in Italy, one of its most important battles was won under the leadership of Quinctius Cincinnatus. Cincinnatus, so the story goes, had been loath to leave his fields and interrupt his plowing in order to raise an army. Even more celebrated than his lack of enthusiasm for high office was Cincinnatus's refusal to extend his command. Turning his back on the possibility of continued power, he returned to his small holding and to his plow. Despite such outstanding exemplars, some of the generals responsible for annexing the richest parts of the Mediterranean proved increasingly reluctant to retire. For these men, the tale of Cincinnatus held no moral force. In the end, the restrictions on the exercise of power imposed by the constitution of a republican city-state proved too weak to withstand the extensive ambitions of empire. In the first century BC, a series of conquering commanders were determined to exploit their success. They held consulships well below the minimum age. They compelled the Senate to renew their military commissions. They relied on the personal loyalty of their troops and the threat of violence to enforce their continued active involvement in politics. When Julius Caesar completed his tour of duty in Gaul, he refused to stand down, as he was constitutionally required to do. In January 49, at the head of his army of veterans battle-hardened after 8 years of campaigning, he crossed the River Rubicon, which marked the southern territorial limit of his command, and marched on Rome. It was now clear that Caesar's authority rested on military might. Some were prepared to oppose this coup d'etat, and by equally illegal means. Caesar's assassination 5 years later, on the Ides of March 44 BC, need not be seen as a virtuous bid for liberty on the part of Brutus and Cassius. Shakespeare's version should be put firmly to one side. It was rather a brutal attempt by one oligarchic faction to wrench political control away from a rival. The result was 2 decades of civil war. Brutus and Cassius were defeated by an alliance of Mark Antony, one of Caesar's closest associates, and Octavian, Caesar's adopted son. In turn, this fragile partnership collapsed. Antony sought help in Egypt and the support of its ruler, Cleopatra. That was a shrewd move. The wealth of Egypt might be used to fund a war against Octavian. Its most important city, Alexandria, on the Nile Delta, might become a new capital for an Eastern Roman Empire. These were serious propositions. It is Octavian's slanderous attacks which presented Mark Antony as a drunken, lovesick, incompetent, caught in the sexual snares of a sensuous Egyptian queen. Such derogatory inventions are the prerogative of the victorious. The destruction of the Egyptian fleet at Actium in 31 BC, and Antony's suicide the following year, secured Octavian's position and smeared his rival's reputation. Under the newly fabricated title of Augustus, the divinely favored one, Octavian's command of the riches and military resources of empire allowed him to establish his family as the unchallenged rulers of the Mediterranean world. The rapid growth of the Roman Empire from the mid-second century BC was itself the cause of the establishment of a dynastic monarchy just over a century later. But it would be over hasty to see that shift as the replacement of freedom by autocracy or of independence by tyranny. Under the emperors, from Augustus on, Roman politics was dominated by privileged families who competed, as they had always done, for the spoils of empire. What had changed was how that rivalry might be regulated, and how those at court close to an emperor might seek to embrace or exclude those in the provinces whose wealth demanded their incorporation into a new empire-wide aristocracy. From that point of view, the transfiguration of Octavian into Augustus, the successful conversion of a warlord into an emperor, was less a fracturing of the fundamental nature of Roman politics than the hard-fought reorganization of power amongst a highly competitive oligarchy. The real Roman Revolution was the founding of an empire under the Republic. It is perhaps unsurprising, too, that after Augustus, the acquisition of new territories was strictly limited. Campaigns in Britain, Dacia, roughly modern Romania, and Mesopotamia were led by emperors themselves. Other military commands were strictly controlled. Potential competitors, even within the imperial household, were carefully policed. This was a severe lesson in risk management well learned. As the vicious civil wars of the first century BC had starkly demonstrated, the glittering prizes of Mediterranean conquest might have made even a Cincinnatus hesitant to return to his plow. Shock and awe. The expansion of a small city-state into an imperial superpower is by any measure an impressive transformation. Rome's empire was secured by an immense military effort which far surpassed any of its opponents, particularly after the defeat of Hannibal. In the 2nd century BC, in order to field an army of around 130,000 men, the Romans not only depended heavily on their Italian allies, but also enlisted around 13% of their own adult male citizens. The call-up fell disproportionately on the young. To sustain an army of such a size required the regular enrollment of 60% of all 17-year-olds for 7 years. In other words, over half of all Roman male citizens might expect to serve in the army until their mid-20s. These are extraordinary statistics. A similar commitment of human resources would not be seen again in pre-industrial Europe until the armies of Frederick the Great of Prussia and Napoleon. And then, only for a fraction of the two centuries, from the Punic Wars to Actium, of Rome's conquest of the Mediterranean world. To give some rough order of magnitude, to match the Roman investment in military manpower, the modern USA would need to maintain a standing army of just under 13 million serving soldiers, well over 10 times its current strength. This huge military establishment created its own dynamic. In its rigorous discipline, in the superior quality of its weapons, and in the campaign experience of its troops, the Roman army exploited the advantages of scale and repeated success. Victory yielded huge quantities of booty. In turn, the riches plundered from defeated enemies, supplemented with revenue from provincial taxation, funded the heavy cost of continued conquest. The wealth generated by Rome's wars in the Eastern Mediterranean was fabled. In 50 years, 200 through 150 BC, the rough equivalent in value of over 30 metric tons of gold was seized. The consolidation of Roman power in Asia Minor and the annexation of Syria meant that even these sums could be exceeded. In 62 BC, the victorious Pompey returned from the east with booty worth nearly 70 tons of gold. 15 years later, the glut of gold extracted by Julius Caesar from Gaul caused the price to drop sharply. The acquisition of empire was nowhere more loudly acclaimed than in Rome itself. The center of the city was crammed with monuments glorifying the advance of Roman rule, grand victory arches, imposing statues, temples brilliantly emblazoned with the spoils of war. Roman historians packed their lengthy narratives with a seemingly endless succession of campaigns and battles. In the 2nd century BC, all those seeking public office were required to have served in the army for at least 10 years as consuls or ex-consuls. Senior military commanders were also successful politicians. Popular folk heroes were the great conquering generals. Fabius Maximus Cunctator, the Delayer, who had seen off Hannibal. Scipio Africanus, the African victor, who had overcome Carthage. Pompey the Great, who had extended the Roman Empire eastwards to the Euphrates. Julius Caesar, who had subjugated the Gauls. The zenith of a Roman political career was a triumphal procession through the streets of the capital, the only time a commander could legitimately lead men under arms into Rome. In June AD 71, the Emperor Vespasian and his son Titus celebrated their brutal suppression of a Jewish revolt. In late summer 70, Titus had besieged and captured Jerusalem. Herod's great temple was sacked, and its inner sanctum, the Holy of Holies, despoiled. Sacred vessels, the gold offering table, the great seven-branched candlestick, menorah, silver trumpets, and the scrolls of the law, Torah, were taken back to Rome and paraded through the streets. 10 years later, in AD 81, that moment of exultation over a vanquished people was permanently commemorated at the eastern approach to the Forum by the building of an arch dedicated to Titus, who had died earlier that year. The arch was a lasting symbol of imperial dominance, its sculptures an indelible reminder of the fate of those who rebelled against Roman rule. All who passed through unavoidably replayed this triumph. For a moment, they too were at the very heart of a conquering empire. On one side, flanked by the treasures from the temple in Jerusalem, on the other by Titus himself, riding in a chariot surrounded by soldiers and escorted by personifications of honor, courage, and victory. The splendid pageantry of a triumph also told the story of the campaign. On great mobile stages 15 meters high, the war was vividly represented in all its cruel detail. These painted tableaux, framed in ivory and gold, allowed an admiring holiday crowd to recapture something of the thrill of conquest, safe in the knowledge that Rome would crush its enemies. One probably eyewitness description is offered by the contemporary Jewish historian Flavius Josephus, perhaps on this occasion straining his generally clear Roman sympathies. Here was to be seen a once prosperous countryside devastated. There, entire enemy war bands slaughtered. Men fleeing and others taken into captivity. Cities whose battlements were crowded with defenders utterly overwhelmed. An army streaming in within the walls, the whole place swimming in blood. The hands of those incapable of resistance raised in supplication. Temples set on fire. Houses pulled down with their owners still inside. And after complete desolation and misery, rivers flowing, not through tilled fields, nor supplying drinking water to men and animals, but through countryside still blazing on all sides. The triumph of Vespasian and Titus, although magnificent, marked the suppression of a revolt rather than the annexation of new territory. Even more extravagant were the spectacles of the first century BC, when the greatest Roman generals paraded their conquests. In September 46, over 12 days of festivities, Julius Caesar celebrated.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.